Dawn Command, fall in for mission 002 of Operation Emberfall. A Phoenix Dawn Command actual play starring the Shrouded Crash. Or no, I'm sorry, the Shrouded Veil, the Forceful Crash, the Devoted Rama, and the Bitter Smoke. I am your Game Marshal, Eddie Doty, here as always. Happy to have you again with us for a what is going to be a very interesting mission. When we last left our wing, they had successfully dispatched the Harvester of Fear in the Morning View Eerie in Sunset, but not without a cost. The Shrouded Veil had to sacrifice her sparks in order to ensure a safe disposal of the Fear Orb that the Harvester was bound to. Doing so advanced her to a rank 2 Phoenix, a rank that she chose to be elemental, because as we know, elementals die for duty. Upon returning from the Crucible, where her new mentor, Kindling, gave her a very detailed PowerPoint presentation on her new abilities. She rendezvoused with the rest of her wing, who were being debriefed by their squadron commander, Rupture, and a mysterious mortal. They were informed of a dispatching squadron or squad of bone chariots that they must investigate to prove a theory or disprove a theory. Upon dropping through the Eerie, our Phoenixes heard a familiar voice, commencing phase 2 of something known as Operation Emberfall. Falling through the eternal flame, they hit hard concrete once again as their hands and feet find the stone of the floor of the Evergreen Eerie outside of Baroque in the Fens, not far from where the Bitter Phoenix Smoke lived her first life. And with that, we will begin. You have landed. There's the haze of dropping, teleporting from the Grand Eerie's fire in the Island of Pyre to your destination. It's familiar, but as you shake off the effects, the room comes into view. I will simply say that it is a great hall. It is a larger Eerie than Morning View and Loch Bianco, the other two areas you've been to. Not as big as Pyre, because nothing is. But clean, modern, well-kept, a cavernous space. The flame chamber, the room you are in, has a vaulted ceiling of a mixture of stone and well-trussed load-bearing structures of oak throughout. It's also well-garrisoned. It is well-populated by guardians, adepts, a flame keeper that you recognize through the ceremonial sash that the flame keepers keep, and seemingly a few mortals as well. Quickly going around the room, I'd like everybody to just like pick out an element that stands out to them to co-create this space that you're in, starting with Smoke, if you don't mind.
Yeah, I would say that there is, I'm gonna say like this place is clean, modern, and well kept, as you said. But if you like look up, it's like got Sistine Chapel levels of like ceiling paintings, and I think that you have the history of the Fens just like stretching out. So we are right now at we're at the Civil Wars with the Phoenixes, and it's done in a I'm gonna say like in an impressionist art style. So you have like, you can see where like the Phoenixes come in with like this like burst of like orange and red, and so that's what the ceiling is. You've got the history just laid out there for you, or a telling of history, because history is written by the winners.
Correct. And you know, it's interesting you say that, because there's definitely an oral or a written tradition of the history of Alona, which is the part of Delea, the kingdom that you're in, that contains the capital, right? So you have the cityscape and the fertile fields and plains of Alona next door to the fens, which technically the fens are part of Alona, but it's the swamps, it's the backwoods, it's a bit more lush and green, and a very different type of living that you know you come from. So the oral traditions that you sort of grew up with, there's a bit of a disconnect between some of the history that you're seeing laid out in that tapestry. And even though you died as a child, you knew enough just from being raised by some of those stories, you're able to pick out parts that just don't quite align with what you've seen. Very cool.
So Smoke is standing there looking up with like a squint in their eyes. What is happening?
Love it. Vale, what's one detail that you see that stands out to you about this flame chamber in this eerie?
Eddie, refresh my memory. Were the candles unique to Pyre?
So the candles are in, so there's a corresponding set of candles with every active eerie and inactive eerie. Mm-hmm. While there may be design changes in how the sconces are made and how they sit on the wall, the overall look and feel of the candles essentially the same. There may be some slight variation in color, but overall, fairly standard process make of candle.
So the first thing Vela is going to notice, because she just regenerated and she's so tuned into the concept of ash right now, is the candle ash wall.
Got it. Is there anything specific that stands out to you that seems different from what you've seen?
It's arranged more contemporarily than the one in Pike. The one in Pike is kind of flowy and it's not really geometric, or if it were, it would kind of be like the geometry of water, like wavy, whereas this is like squares and angles and just very different. It kind of sort of reminds her of something she saw in her first life, but she can't really put a finger on it.
Love it. Fantastic. Yeah, you see that there, and you see that unlike the Morning View Eerie, which was fully stocked, this has several adepts who are kind of always looking and sort of seem to be discussing like what message to send forward. You can tell one of them has, they sent essentially a clipboard with some recent thing that they've jotted down. You can't quite tell what, but they're having a conversation about how best to communicate this and what is essentially a magical Bronze Age version of Morse code, which is what flame communication and candle codes essentially are. Okay, cool. Crash, anything stand out to you?
Yes, I see several shelves of books.
Indeed you do.
Yeah, that's it.
You see several series of books. You notice that this is like the first time you've seen probably the biggest library in an eerie. Outside of the great library, which was like a whole part of a floor in Pyre, right? So like in the Grand Eyrie Empire, that is the headquarters. It feels very much like definitive source of knowledge. But this one has a fairly well-stocked one. The other thing you notice is about a third of the books have been pulled, and somewhat recently. Books that are half-stocked in a library shelf over time fall over and kind of lean into each other. These are still sort of keeping freshly pulled slots. So you can tell about 8 to 10 books have been pulled fairly recently. All right, Rama.
In the center of this room, there's this like, it's a collection of pillars that are made of like concrete. So it kind of looks like a bundle, but they're cut off at different levels. And it's like, there's like a water feature and like sort of drapey vines coming off of it. And like some of the lower like severed pillars are like where people can sit, like there's like a cushion, but it's just this like central geometric, it's that clean, like clean minimalist, but like there's a sense of like trying to pull an artistic sense of nature, and you can like kind of hear the water trickling through. It's not enough to need like a pool or like grating or anything. It just sort of trickles through this like concrete fixture.
100%. This is that primitive form of concrete that's made from a mixture of like certain types of muds and clays, but also like ground up snail shells that provide like a kind of like an early form of like glue and early brick making that you would see in Australian and Filipino style thatch huts. So it's, but with that is obviously a very intricate design. You're seeing how the water flows. It kind of gives you a sense of the area around you, in that there's a lot of like flowing delta water, you know, and tributaries and stuff like that. So, yeah, that's fantastic. So you drop, and almost immediately, let me bring my notes up. Almost immediately, you are approached by two, you are approached immediately by like two, by the lead guardian. The guardian is a mortal who is kind of leads like the military aspect of this. And then also the flame keeper immediately approach you. I'm sorry, I apologize greatly. I'm going to need about 10 seconds to pull up in my note document. I'm so sorry, I got accidentally closed. So my apologies on that. While that happens, I will give time to you to have any sort of discussion around this while you see these people approach you.
Smoke's looking up.
Yeah, I follow their eye line and just look up like, oh, okay. Interesting. Are you familiar with this story?
Not this version. They got some stuff wrong.
Hmm.
Who do you think we talked to about that?
Oh, probably no one. But if we find paint, we can go up and fix it ourselves.
No. No. Rama, no.
How do you know died? Things are different now.
I was gone for a day. Wasn't I? Wait, how long was I gone?
It's been years.
You're lying.
Would like to go find some paint.
Crash just shakes her head.
So with that, you're immediately approached by the flame keeper. Let's see. Smoke, why don't you go ahead and describe what this mortal male looks like?
Yeah, I would say so. Lush. Okay, I think this mortal male is. He has a very wide face, and I'm going to say his, and just like angular cheekbones, and just like dark, like almond, like shaped eyes. I would say that he is wearing a vest. That is white, like the crushed shells. Like it's got the exact same like tone and almost like the exact same texture, like maybe like a linen or a cotton. He has two orange stripes across his chest that look like they're like tattooed on. And then I would say he is wearing Let's give him like a harong or like a skirt sort of thing.
Okay.
And let's make it like red with like a floral pattern. And but he looks official, I would say. I would not say this is casual wear. This feels like this is wear that is important.
100%. Okay. So he comes up to you and says, "Blessings, Phoenixes. Thank you for coming. How was your travel?"
"Uneventful, thank you."
"All right.
Here to observe.
Do you require anything before we begin?"
I look over at Vale specifically.
"Privacy?"
"Privacy will be in short supply. It's we are well staffed and garrisoned to begin with, and recent days have prevented that. But if all is well, I will be happy to introduce you to your guardian page for the day." He is, and then the guardian in full standard guardian garb goes, "Tad Mackleton, right here for you. We're here to escort you to the third floor, which is the observation chamber. And if there's no further delay, we will absolutely proceed there now, my wing, as he sort of does like a sort of a half bow.
Just want to clarify, is the Flame Keeper the one that's wearing the red and white floral?
Yes, song? Correct.
And then Tad Mackleton.
Tad Mackleton.
Okay, thank you.
Yes. Yeah, the Flame Keeper is the one who tends to the flame in the Eyrie, therefore basically the counterpart to Cinder. There are mortals who learn ash sorcery and they cannot send anyone back, but they know how to interpret and know when someone is being deployed through a flame. So he's the one who maintains just the integrity of the flame in the Eyrie.
Okay, if we're standing here, mm-hmm. I'm going to, like a child, tug on Rama's clothing. We should go if the bone chariots will not wait.
You're right.
Tab goes, all right then, it's agreed. Follow me. And leads you up to the third chamber. It's interesting. This is to the third floor. This is a fairly present structure. If someone were to tell you this was the second largest Eyrie, you wouldn't be surprised. That isn't necessarily the case, but this is definitely the largest one outside of the Grand Eyrie you've seen. You make your way up to the third floor, and the third floor is interesting because it is a round room with 180 degrees being glass. And I'd say veil, just from being observant as a passive, you can tell it's volcanic glass, most likely imported from Pyre. It has just a little bit of that smokiness around the edges and a little bit of imperfections and kind of, it seems much more ceremonial than functional. But you go into the room, and within the room, there is one person, a mortal woman, roughly 35 years old, wearing a suit that is slightly disheveled, the collar open. You could tell they've probably been in these clothes more than 24 hours. Their back is to you. They are facing out. There's three seemingly high-powered telescopes in the room facing, all kind of moved to face north by northeast, and a table where there's just stacks of books, a few scattered chairs here and there. You can approach, you can take whatever else is in, you can observe, you can do whatever you want at this point.
I think that Smoke goes to stand in front of the woman. They're ready to get on this mission. They want to get to the Bone Chariots ASAP, so they're not going to go. They can probably read at this point. Actually, I don't know if Smoke can read. We'll cross that bridge when we come to it.
Let's do a check.
Right now.
We can check against that later. That'll be a fun interaction.
Yeah.
What's everybody else doing? So Smoke, as usual, is making a beeline towards the objective, or towards the only other person in the room. What is the rest of the wing doing?
I'm backing up Smoke.
I'm going to the window and looking at what I can see, if I can see anything, what I can see on the other side.
You can. You can see, so the Fens and the rest of mainland Alona is separated by a fairly small, it's not a river because it breaks in the ocean, but it's essentially a small shoreline called the Verdant Coast. So you can see that line of demarcation from the Fens to the Verdant Coast. And you can see where the swamp kind of ends and like sandy beaches begin, sandy beaches that give way to like green and fertile fields. Beyond that, you can see the ruins of a city. And beyond that, you can see the horizon. And that's all you can see without any additional aid. Everybody approaches, and this woman is looking through this high-powered, it's a double-lens telescope, so both of her eyes are completely obscured by this. But seemingly out of nowhere, she says, thank goodness you've arrived. She breaks away, and you see bags under her eyes contributing to this notion that she has not slept in quite some time. She motions over to the table where there's enough chairs for you all to sit. And as you all kind of gather your place, she says, I know you've been given a very modest briefing. My name is Atithi Huang. I am a historian for the House Deu Talo. There are people who would kill for that information. And the only reason we're having this conversation in this room, which as you can see, no one else is in, is that against some of our better judgment, our mistress is willing to share our information with you so that we may determine what is heading for our home.
If your mistress has decided that you need to share information with us, it's most likely because she needs our help, and so do you. For starters, why haven't you slept?
Her eyes dip down, and she just gestures towards the telescope. And while only one of them is trained in the exact direction that she was, the rest of you get a general sense of what she was looking at.
I'd like to walk over and look into the telescope.
Give me a grace check. And I'll just go ahead and say, goes without saying, you can use your scouting.
Yes. Great. So skill check is 3. Three. So I'm going to start with a 4 in strength.
Great.
I'll use a 3 in grace. I will use a 2 in grace, and I will draw a card because of that 2. That's not...
Forcefuls get to draw cards on 2s.
It's the best.
It is the best. Card draw.
So 4, 5. So I'm at 14 right now total. I will spend a spark to bump it.
Hey, there we go. Spark boost you to 15. Okay. There was mention of this in the briefing, and... you didn't quite understand it because you were coming off of a mission and it was kind of tense in the room and your GM didn't do a good job articulating it. But you look trained in the distance and you can see it all kind of comes into a clear picture now. There is a line, just like there's a line of demarcation of swamp to coast to fertile plains land, there's a line of demarcation between that and what is a artificially created devastation to the landscape to slow down a massive army, probably about 7,000 to 8,000 strong, of undead Bone Legion. And you've heard of the Bone Legion. You've trained with effigies, training dummies resembling the Bone Legion. This is your first time seeing it, and it is horrifying. You are seeing 7,000 strong, obviously in military garb of some kind, in various states of decay, but all roughly around the same state of decay. You're seeing a thin glow around it. Peter Jackson's The Frighteners style green glow, or Return of the King Ghost, whatever you want to call it as. But you're seeing just a little bit of a fading ectoplasmic sheath around this undead army. There are no facial expressions because the faces are long gone. There is bits of flesh against rotting skeleton, armor that is rusted and decayed. You can see elements of something, but they move in uniform purpose. They're moving very slowly, however. Except for 5 bone chariots. And Jake, we can see that card now.
I want to see the card.
These are chariots drawn by undead horse. They're not quite single person chariot like Ben-Hur. They're not quite full carts, but they fit approximately 3 to 5 bone soldiers each. There is some sort of device mounted on the front of it. It does not appear to be a ballast or a ballista or a crossbow of any kind. It just seems to be like a large tube on each of them. They have broken away from the main pack and are going in a slightly north by northwest direction, distinctly away from the pack. They're currently about, I'd say, 800 to 900 yards ahead of the main pack. Stand by 1 second.
Seems easy. We should be fine.
My daughter's joined us. So you see that, and I'll say on a 15, you know, because there are other bone chariots in the main host, but these bone chariots, there just seem to be something a little different about their movements. Not necessarily a panic, but definitely a hurry, like their arms, like flapping the reins a little bit more aggressively. It all seems very mindless, the movements, almost like an afterthought. There's no like personal flourish to movements. There's no like sense of personality you're getting from any of them. It's just like a very factual, like, I am going over here and therefore I am moving these horses to do that. The other key takeaway that you notice is that in about 200 yards, no, let's say 100 yards, they're going to break free of the battlements and they are going to hit open ground and their wheels are intact. So based on this, just by, you're putting numbers together in your head and you're thinking like, okay, this, and you're trying to estimate, and just as you're about to come to a conclusion, you hear her say, 15 minutes. We've done the math. 15 minutes, they'll be in open ground. 15 minutes, based on the calculations we've made, they will be upon a small village in 90 minutes after.
Did you evacuate the village?
We've sent word. It's mostly evacuated, but some of these small towns near the fens, and you can hear her eyes roll. Some of these small towns near the fens tend not to evacuate even when they're told. It's all they've ever known.
I think that the second this, their pronouns are she, her, right?
Best you can tell, yes.
Yes, okay. So the second she introduced herself as from the Deu Talu house,
Deu Talu,
great.
Yeah.
I think that you hear, like, you know when your dog is like about to bark, but it knows it's not supposed to bark, and so it kind of makes like a low rumble in their throat.
Oh yes,
absolutely. That with this woman. And they're not enjoying the way that she also said that. But can Smoke remember what the house god for the Deu Talu house is?
What are your skill traditions?
Strength and grace.
No, your skill specialties.
Oh, my skill traditions. Athletics, fear, shadows, death.
Actually,
death.
I'm going to allow death on this one. Go ahead and give me a grace spread, please.
Nice. Well, all I have is 1-4 in grace in my hand right now.
Well, if it's a skill, you can use grace for strength on it.
Oh, yes. Actually, let me think. I don't think Death Wish, Reckless, or Feral would work in this situation.
Definitely not.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
That's okay. So we got a 9. Because my skill specialty and then this.
Yep.
I'm going to help out a little bit. I'm going to burn Savior and add 5 to your spread.
Ooh.
Okay, so, by the way, fun thing happened between your focal length and hit rate, it made it look like the card was censored.
Just like, yeah, it's like, ooh, it's not. It's I did the weird blurry background on here. It's a bad idea. I don't know why I did it. I made mistakes.
I encounter that with my cast on one of my other channels that will not go named at this point. But I'm always telling them, please don't move back 2 inches because then it looks like you're in the witness protection program. So go ahead and give me your spread. So what is that? What does that card do, Abria? What does that do for her?
It's just I can discard Savior at any time to add 5 to the value of a wing spread.
Go ahead and give me the rest of that spread.
So then with that, it's a 4 in grace, so the 5 with the Bria gave me. So that's a 9 plus a 5 in my skill specialty of death. And that brings me up to a 14.
Okay.
Spend one spark. Spend a spark. What do you do? Get to 15.
Okay. 15. Spend a spark.
Good heavens.
Apologies for chewing.
Hey, spark daddy.
So, spark daddy.
Oh, Spark Daddy doesn't kick in yet. Give it a second. Y'all need to start spending sparks before I start giving them back.
All right. The Deotalu. There's different houses, and these houses go back to pre-Delayan Empire. So before the Empire was a thing, before the Dawn Legion unified all the different parts of the continent into one solidified kingdom, there were... In Alona, there were different houses, not dissimilar from like Game of Thrones and like, you know, the different houses that you have there, or even War of the Roses with the Yorks and the Lancasters and things like that. The houses had different specialties based on whatever goods or services they could provide to their neighbors. The Deotalu is also commonly referred to as the House of Coin. They are very... and by extension, there's a lot of allegations, and this is where you would know about it with death. There's a lot of rumor, especially amongst rural folk, that the Deotalu is associated with organized crime.
Right, and also like smugglers and piracy.
Smugglers, piracy. Yeah. The other bit of it that you would know, and I'm just going to say this is non... Yes, this is my favorite episode too. Is the non... this is more from your Phoenix training. You know that the current speaker, because in the way the Empire works is that there's an emperor, and then each region of the world has like a different ministers, and each part of the country elects someone to serve as speaker. You know that the current speaker for Alona is of Deotalu, or the Deo House. So you know that obviously, this person is well-connected and wealthy, but you also know that the speaker for Alona, her name is Kasala Deosa. You know that she is universally loved by everybody. She's seen as potentially, you know, someone who has a lot of influence over the emperor, but you also know there's just a lot of rumor and sort of shade associated with her house, but you don't know where the oral tradition of your history begins and the written history ends. You don't know where she is on that line. All right. So, Crash, you've observed this, and you hear Tytha say, in 15 minutes, the 90-minute countdown begins until these bones are on this town. In that 90 minutes, we must find out as much as we can. And this is where the challenge lies, Wing 023. You have been ordered not to directly engage. You are not Talon free on this squad of bone chariots unless you are directly engaged upon. You can observe from here, but no offense, if you learn anything I haven't learned in the last 72 hours, then you truly are impressive. If you all go into the field to study, you won't have access to the knowledge that you both possess and that we both brought. She's pointing to the table full of books. So, if you decide Divide your efforts. I have been authorized to share with you these. She pulls a briefcase that you did not see from the side of the table. And she opens up. And in that, you see four ear brooches. They're not like earrings. They go around the ear. And they're each shaped like a phoenix wing. And she says, you know, ever since you phoenixes came back a little while ago, a funny thing has been happening with some of our friends who dabble in magic. We originally developed this to, let's say, communicate with each other in sensitive areas, but we're willing to share this with you. And she gestures you to take one.
I mean, I'm for sure going to take it, but I am trying very hard to maintain a neutral face. Thank goodness her eyes appear shut all the time. Just thinking shady thoughts.
Vale takes it, but she's not going to try. She's just going to go, you mean you created these to more effectively spy on your enemies?
Okay, listen. No. I mean...
It's not an insult.
Could it?
I'm just curious as to whether we're your friend or your enemy.
Okay, so yes. And if someone needs help and they cannot call for help or wants to communicate an important idea, certainly these could be used for that too. Humanitarian reasons.
So you can radio the village right now and find out how the evacuation is going.
They don't have these.
Why?
There are four of these in the world.
In the world?
Yes.
I don't believe her. Can I do a thing about it? I feel like there's a fifth and she's going to be listening in.
Give me an intellect check.
Yes. Let's
can
go.
Can I run one too since I'm having the conversation, or would that be redundant?
You both can do it through different. Okay. You're both gonna do it, but I'm gonna prescribe which skill check you're gonna use. You're gonna do Vale, Spycraft.
Okay.
And Rama.
Diplomacy.
Yeah. Diplomacy.
Blah, blah, blah.
We'll call it that.
Diplomacy. Cool, cool, cool. Sweet. I've got straight fours across the board. No special cards, but just 12 plus 5 is 17.
17?
Yep.
17. Okay. Far as you can tell, she is telling you.
Get me out of here. I'm going to burn 3 sparks. I'm going to 20.
20. Okay. All right. Okay.
Wait.
Okay, go ahead.
I have seen this before. Can I just... guard this to add 3 without her having to burn sparks?
Yes, I'll allow that.
Thank you.
Okay. This case that it's in has very tailored, manicured wells that each one rests properly into. You can tell that whatever these are comes at great cost, high value, and was designed with these four in mind. You get the impression that she's telling the truth, and that if there is a fifth one, or a sixth one, or a seventh one, they don't look quite like this. They would probably be, you have reason to believe that it would look more crude, more prototype-ish, but these are definitely, as far as you can tell, especially just the way she, like, she didn't just lift up the case and yank it up. She, like, slowly lifted, and her other hand was there to guide it over. These are of great value to her. And there does seem to be a reluctance in her handing these to you. So as best as you can tell, you feel like these are safe and secure channels to be in. Does anybody want to put them on?
I'll put mine on. And, Rama's going to thank her. Sincerely, like, I cannot imagine the cost of artifacts such as this. It's greatly appreciated, and we will do what we can.
She stares
your home.
She stares off into a single kind of in the distance and said, "Yes. Cost is a word that takes on new meaning every day. So, please place them around your ear. They shouldn't be too uncomfortable with you." And with Smoke, she goes down and like adjusts it on, or she goes to at least.
Smoke is actually over by the window with like full face pressed up against the window, like a kid. Like kids in a way, there's germs, like you don't know what's been there, but like just like face pressed up against the window, just like observing. So if it comes over and puts it over her ear, that's so Smoke kind of like lets it happen.
She's trying to get your hair out of the way, but like, cause like it's just like face and hair, and she's like, if you put this,
Smoke kind of turns, but is not really offering it. And okay. You have a kid, you know what it's like to put on clothes when they don't want
to. Yep. She's like, okay, thank you so much.
She turns.
They cannot communicate direct thought. They cannot communicate specific sentences. What they can communicate are impressions and ideas. And if a phoenix such as yourself, this is where it gets interesting, if a phoenix such as yourself imbues it with a little bit of power, we have reason to believe that specific moments of, we theorize 1 to 3 seconds, the exact not just the image, but the full sensory experience could be transmitted at cost to your spark. But overall, without having to make that commitment, you should get very specific, clear, brief details up to a range of probably 2,000 meters. So up to a certain point and she kind of points out the glass and says, that essentially extends you up to about here. And where she points at is just before the first cottage of a, you know, leading into sort of a larger village. There is like one cottage that's kind of like first, and then a couple, and then the rest of the town proper. And that's what she's sort of pointing at you currently. But up until then, it should be good. Listen, this is lovely. It's nice to see faces again. But I must ask that you make a decision promptly into how you determine to assess the situation and learn what you can. There are books at your disposal. Obviously, those will make, they're only so good without in the field observations, but it's to your comfort level, the risk you're willing to take to learn what we can about these things.
I want to give a look of, please let us talk for a second. Like, how can I convey without diplomatically, please bugger off for a minute so we can talk?
So the thought is, please bugger off as we can talk. Yeah. It sounds like somebody needs to make a diplomacy check.
Oh no. Okay. Let's go. All right. this was a very bad pull. Oh, I have charming. Here we go. Sweet. All right. I've got very bad cards. So I've got 3s in grace and intellect and a 2 in intellect. So total of 8 plus charming. I'm going to be very pleasant about this.
Cool.
9. And then plus 5 is 14. And I'll burn 1 spark to get to 15.
All right. 15. It doesn't take much, but you are able, you can tell she normally cares very much about her appearance, and she's used to being in heavy diplomatic situations, and you being very tall and slender and graceful with a very striking appearance, as you all do, but yes. The dread hawk is doing it for her. So, so she says, yes, of course, take whatever time you need. I must go get some water. And so she walks and she walks off. The room is yours, 100%.
Okay. I'm going to slip the thing off my ear. Just in case. All right. Well, I think it needs to be said that we should consider not going out into the fields to resist the temptation of engaging with the bone chariots. And I kind of give a little look at Smoke as I say that.
Smoke's not looking at you. Smoke's looking at the window.
Yeah, I mean, I'm looking in Smoke's direction. That's to fair. Convey that to the group. Just, if we observe from here, we could gather information, we could research. The closer we get, the higher the likelihood is that we will engage the bone chariots. What do you want to do?
Not go out there. That town's getting overrun. And I don't necessarily believe they fully evacuated it.
Well, we are in a position to speed that evacuation up. Some of us are very fast.
I was thinking maybe, yes, I agree, we should do a lot of research here, but I'd also like to just go out for a quick, super fast scout.
Alone?
Yeah, I'll be quick.
I don't think so. I'll go with you.
Will you well, keep up with her?
You'll follow behind you.
Okay. Then, yeah. That's what I plan to do.
Smoke, are you comfortable staying here?
Smoke, can you stay here without causing any trouble?
Oh, I mean, I'm not going to ask for the moon on this one. You can cause as much trouble as you want here.
No, if she causes trouble and gets killed, she leaves them Phoenix Ash, and we were told not to do that. In fact, it kind of sounded to me like we might become Ash ourselves if we accidentally do that.
I would rather come with.
Yeah, that's my struggle.
Okay.
Now we're all going.
All right. New plan. I'll stay. You go with Crash.
What? No. How about no one goes with Crash? This is nothing against Crash. Crash is very fast.
My thought is if she gets into trouble, she'll be on her own. We'll be back at the tower. At a minimum, we should try and be outside.
Buddy system.
It's not you, Smoke. And I don't care if you stab me again about it. It's not going to be you.
Staying here or going out?
What, Smoke going out? If Smoke goes outside, Smoke's going to fight all of the bone chariots. They may win. I'm actually not sure how that's going to go.
All right. So, Rama, you go with Crash. I'll stay with Smoke.
Okay. Yeah. I guess I will do my best to not physically hold you back. And if anything happens, I'll negotiate with the dead soldiers. This is fine. Let's just go.
Run back this way. If anything happens, run back this way.
We have time. The bone soldiers aren't going to be at that village for another 90 plus 15 minutes. So we have time. We're running to the village. I'm going to run to the village and then I'm going to run back and just let you know. I just want to know what the status is of if they actually know they need to evacuate or if, you know. And actually, I can be the one to tell them that if they haven't gotten word yet.
I love Absolutely. How none of us believe her.
Oh, yeah, not at all.
None of us believe her at all.
Not even a little bit.
Not even a little bit, no. So the question is, what do Smoke and I do? Look at the books and look through the telescope?
I see what you can see of their, like, macro movements.
Yeah.
Press.
Okay. Gathering.
Press that house woman. For more information, find out what you can.
Smoke is displeased. You basically saddled her up with a babysitter.
I'm happy if Smoke wants to, like, fuss
I'm
about it.
I'm not the one that said Smoke couldn't go, so Vale's just kind of like, I'm not the one that said you couldn't go.
Fight Smoke picks his Rama later.
From outside the room, you hear a Tytha say, I've had my water.
Oh my god.
And then my daughter's water. So, how's it going in there?
Better if you'd give us more space. Thank you.
The bone
okay, we are on.
No, before I decide to leave, she says to Rama and Crash.
Crash, we need to go.
Let's go.
So Crash and Rama are out the door, and then yeah. Smoke and Vale are going to stay behind. Okay, got it.
We're literally going to like go through the door and just like bypass. Oh gosh, what was her name?
Atitha.
Vale, if you could just hold Smoke by the back of their shirt, that would be great.
That's exactly what she's doing. She's like, whoa, whoa.
Because Smoke does try to inch towards the door and does not escape you.
All right, we're gonna fast forward a little bit. So you make your way. So Crash and Rama, you make your way outside. You get outside and you see the thicket and the bramble of the fens. I'll say most mortals would not be able to cross the crossing over onto the Verdant Coast. But as phoenixes, it's not even a significant challenge for you to make an extraordinary leap across that, even you, Rama, like you have enough physical prowess to be able to do, you know, things sort of above what most mortals can do. You get down to the coastline, ready to begin, going back up to, and as you do that, Crash, what's your first thought upon seeing the shoreline, the Verdant Coast, and then off in the distance, your objective? Like, what is your thought, if you could sum it up?
I'm wondering how far it is and how long it'll take me to get there to the village.
So you start thinking that in your mind, like of how fast, how far, how long, and everybody else in the wing is able to hear that thought. Mm-hmm. It's not purely telepathic. Don't worry, you're not going to have embarrassing fourth grade secrets be made public to everybody. But anything pertaining specifically to this focused objective of observing the Bone Legion and trying to study its connection and its source of power, anything regarding that seems, which is your common unifying purpose, your mission, that seems to be transmitted across the wing. Vale, right now, you're up in the observation chamber. What is your thought looking through the glass?
I trust both of them completely, but I also have an overwhelming sense of doom. Since we've been trapped already once, and we heard the, what was the exact wording we heard? The Emberfall statement for the second time, making it more clear that really wasn't meant for us. It's something else. I'm suspicious of literally everybody who's not in my way. So I'm like trying to keep an eye out of the window with this like overwhelming sense of doom. And I'm trying to keep an eye on the feral child. And I'm trying to keep an eye on these mortals that I've been specifically told not to trust. Val's a little stressed.
Got it. That stress translates to the equivalent of static on like a far band radio. It's not white noise of, but it does kind of come across as like flittering ADHD thoughts scrambling your sense of objective and purpose. So it doesn't distract, it doesn't take you off objective, but you are noticing that as that communication process happens. Does anybody else have any overriding thought they'd like to contribute to the group chat?
Yeah. So with the Deotella, did you say what their house god was?
Don't know.
Okay, got it.
You don't know what their house god is. And the way house gods work, house gods, house of coin. So uh-huh. you would associate it with, you know, a god that favors that. The way it's a weird relationship in the sense that mm-hmm. they both take influence from the house god and directly influence the house god.
Yeah.
And so like whatever they feel is like their own, you know, origination or their own family pride, there's always that blurry line of is it because the house god influenced them or did their house god take on those characteristics of them? You don't know where that line begins and ends.
Okay, so then I say in the group chat, what you feel Smoke feeling is you see them like trying to like conceptualize like the under it's strong feelings of violence towards the like an unknown concept. So it's like violence but also confusion. And so if you could see into their mind's eye right now, you'd see them cycling through various like imagery of like wealth and like just trying to like, how do you kill wealth? How do you kill
yeah
wealth? And so yeah, that's what smoke's mind's eye right now.
Very cool. All right, so now is where the fun begins. You have a mission objective that is very clear. You are to not directly engage unless engaged upon, but observe the trajectory and path of these bone chariots. There are competing hypotheses of their origin and what could possibly be behind them. What you are trying to do is either prove or disprove existing theories. The two existing theories are there's magician like warlocks or necromancers directly controlling them, or that these are restless ghosts reliving a previous action. We are going to do, and what is Phoenix Dawn Command is called, an extended skill spread, meaning we will do initiative. Everybody is going to take an action that can
Eddie. And no, I cannot hear you.
Oh, no, I can't hear you.
Oh, no, wait. I can lip read, though, kind of. One moment.
Okay.
Wait up. 1 second. Reloading.
All you get from Rama the whole time is just, oh, God, keep up. Don't fall behind.
Are we good?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank God. My daughter yanked out the headphone cable, and every time it does that, I have to refresh Chrome, and it's a whole thing. All right. So we are doing what's called an extended skill spread. You have a total DC of 80 that you have to hit. Each of you are going to make a skill contribution to this. Oh, and now we lost Aaron.
Yeah. I think Elisa's frozen too.
Oh, there we go. No, she's back. Your DC is 80 total. We are going to take turns, and it's going to work in the same initiative order. I'm going to choose somebody. You're going to pass the torch to somebody else. We're not going to do environmental effects the same way as we normally do. As you encounter, if the field crew, as you encounter or head towards a specific new area or vista, I will introduce 1 to 2 elements that you can feel free to use or not use. For the homeschool kids back in the observation deck near the library, you have whatever is at your resources to do to piece together pieces of information. It's essentially going to work as the people in the front in the field being forward observers, taking note of stuff. You can cross-check against books, traditions of being locally from that region, smoke, whatever you want to do to contribute to that. If you guys want to swap places and exchange who's in the field and who's back in the observation tower, you certainly can. You have a set series of books here. The rest of the library is downstairs. These books in this observation room is what Scythe has pulled for you. There are other books that you can feel free to go look and explore. You can talk to people in the building and get their impressions. If you don't know specific pieces of information, you can cross-reference what you're observing through traditions, histories, anything in the books. It's entirely up to you. I'm going to tell you right now, it's going to require both. Not one team is going to find any success to this. And what your action is and the skill check against it is going to help resolve this condition of 80. So, and you have, I'm going to say, we're going to advance the Bone Legion as they get closer and closer to the village. Once they're in the village, there really is no stopping them. So doing what's on the mission and evacuating any and all humans entirely up to you, how you want to decide that. If you want to prioritize the mission, you can prioritize the mission. If you want to evacuate humans, you can. It just won't advance your skill check that you need. And to be clear, your mission, baby girl, your mission is to is to find out the answers. 1 second, please. There you go, honey. There you go. So that is your mission. I will say this first round, The bone chariots are still in the roughage, but they are about to break free. So by the end of this first round, they will be in open field. And at that point, their pace increases significantly. So with that said, who would like to go first?
Sure. Yeah, I'll go. Let's go.
How would you like to contribute to the skill check?
Once we get down onto the field, I want to get as close as I can to see if I can hear them talking at all. I want to see if I hear like intelligence coming from them, to see if there's like troop movements or choices being made in the moment, or if it just seems like this, like if there is talking at all, if it's like rote recitation of like things that were said. I'm listening for intelligent thought if we're trying to figure out.
To get that close, they would most assuredly notice you and possibly engage you.
Okay.
And this is not a spoiler to say, if you are about to engage the Bone Legion, the whole host of the Bone Legion, let alone these five bone chariots.
I'm sure I would be fine fighting 7,000 bone soldiers with my lantern. Yeah, we're good.
But even five chariots, that's a challenge on your own. So you don't need any high level intelligence to decipher that. Like you get a strong sense that at like the whole wing maybe, but like one Phoenix alone against a squad of five bone chariots is probably not gonna cut it. Let's do this. Give me an intelligence check.
Okay. Shoot. Is there any way I can make this work for tradition? Because I'm trying.
Spirits.
Sorry. Oh, spirits. Yeah. They're bone people. What am I doing? What a world. Okay. This is going to be a real janky spread. So I've got 7 total off of normal cards. And then I can do. I want to try to use Warlock just because I think her experiences with the fallen folk and the sort of like not, it does look censored every time. these like not human people, like she's spent so much of her first life as that bridge between like people of the dusk and the living world that I think she doesn't have the same sense of fear as she tries to like get information.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Go ahead and give me that number.
All right. Hold on. I kind of want to use curse too. No. I'm going to keep that for later. Never mind.
I don't think curse would apply here actually.
Okay. That's fair. 8 and I will burn 8 plus 13, burning 2 sparks to get to 15.
Okay, so one thing I do want to, and that's fine that you do that. One thing I do want to do is that the traditional skill spread of hitting these increments of 5 for DC is you don't quite, this is an extended skill spread. I'm going for an overall point total. So I would say be judicious with your sparks. Don't have to hit intervals of 5 every time on this since everybody's pulling all of their numbers together. I have my little calculator here. If you want to burn 2 here, you can.
I'm still going to spend them, yeah.
Okay, all right, so 15. Sounds good. All right, so what you're able to do is just look and just, you know, look and sort of see the way they move. The thing you're able to determine out the gate is that these have nothing to do with the Fallen. Warlock and Phoenix Dawn Command, you know, there's a connotation with Warlock of like either patron saint or controlling an undead army like a necromancer. This isn't Fallen folk. This has nothing to do with that. So it's not a case of spirits with agency negotiating with mortals, having a shared space or shared experience with mortals. It's nothing like that. Because that is determined by intelligence. There's a clear thought process with the Fallen. Mm-hmm. They can communicate, they have agency. You're not seeing that here.
I think the like the vibe that comes through to the rest of the group is just this like sudden like rush, like cold water of dread when she realizes it has nothing to do with the Fallen and she doesn't know how to negotiate with a thing that doesn't negotiate. I think that's like a very Rama specific anxiety.
So who would you like to pass the torch to next?
I'm going to pass it to Smoke.
All right. So Smoke, you receive that. You receive, you know, you've encountered the Fallen now. You've observed the Fallen directly. And you know with a certainty that Rama has, it's almost as though you're sharing her expertise in a brief moment, that this is not that.
Yeah. Smoke is not on the battlefield. So this is weird for them because they have to strategize from afar. But you mentioned the presence of marshland, right?
Yes.
And so I think that what Smoke is going to try and do is we're on a clock right now. And what this is me like explaining to you, the GM, like what my intentions with my next actions are.
Okay. Totally cool.
I think Smoke wants to try and give us an advantage in terms of time, like maybe even give us a little bit more time by stretching out that time. And so she'd like to observe where the marshland begins and ends, and if there's any way to almost like get them caught in that marsh. And so the way that they would like to do that is to see if, like, we can obviously observe, but if there's any maps in this room of the layout in front of us. Smoke maybe can't read, but they can look at fine pictures. They're going to find the big picture of the land in front of us and try and find the marshland in hopes of transferring that information to their group so they can lead this Bone Legion. No, we're only supposed to observe, but lead this Bone Legion through the marshland and hopefully get them stuck. This is our grand plan.
Grace check.
Grace check. Great. I only have a 4 in grace. Fuck.
And I don't think your skill specialties apply. So I think this is going to be just a naked grace check on its own.
You got a 4 in grace.
All right.
And then I draw one card when you use this card in a spread. If you have at least one wound. Okay, I want to use this. I want to use Feral. Can I use Feral? Because it says draw one card if you use this card in a spread. But I can't
use
Strength, right?
Yes. Yeah, you can use it. I'm going to let you use it. I want you to describe for me how Smoke understands the land of this area as a feral animal would. I want you to describe to me what that feels like for her.
I think that for Smoke, Smoke is like part animal, right? And I think that at this point, and I think that like an animal, they know what traps, right? And so I think that they know what kind of ground like to like avoid, and they know like how to run. I think that their time in the Crucible, they've either been fighting or running from creatures, and so I think that this like kind of feeds into that. So they're like, there's something coming towards me, and I need to run away from it. I'm going to lead it down a dark like. Down a path in which it cannot follow me. I need to find that path in front of me.
I want to open that up a little bit because not everybody, certainly not the audience, but definitely I don't even think your wing knows how different your Crucible experience was compared to many others. Do you want to just briefly share flashes of imagery?
Yeah. So flashes of imagery. So Smoke had no mentor. In the Crucible, that's what it makes a bitter. And they entered the Crucible a child, and they are in many ways still a child, but they are a child that has existed in this space for centuries. The Crucible is the Crucible. I imagine it a dark landscape. If you've ever been to like northern Alaska when it's like land of no sun, that's what Smoke's experience was, like barren wasteland but with moving shadows And so the landscape was forever shifting around them. And the main object, if you were to look in this most mind's eye right now, is a tiger. Like, you see them being hunted by a tiger. And this tiger shows up in many forms, in sometimes multiple forms. And that was Smoke's, part of Smoke's experience. So Smoke is used to running, but Smoke is also used to killing. And that's where we're at.
Yeah. So, you all... Cool. All right. And so how, point total on that, please.
Okay. Give me just a second. I'm going to see if there's literally anything else I can do.
Okay. Take your time. So while Rivety resolves that, you get, oh my goodness, you get the sense definitely that she, you get the sense of just like this feeling of isolation and loneliness that none of you had as your time in the Crucible. For many of you, your time in the Crucible was a time of self-discovery and growth and knowledge and acceptance because you had a mentor, because you had someone to walk you through it. And for the first time, you're really realizing just how alone Smoke has been for so long.
Yeah. So the card I drew, because I'm allowed to, because with Feral, I drew one grace card, which is great, but it's missed that you, when you use this card in a spread, draw two cards and place one of those cards back on top of your deck. So I'm going to go ahead and use it and then draw two cards, and hopefully one of those will be a grace card. Neither of them grace cards. Fuck me. That's fine. I think I'm going to burn sparks at this point. I would like to burn a few sparks.
Okay. You certainly can.
Yeah.
I would just remind you that we're going to do several rounds of this.
Shit, I know.
Can I interject?
Yes.
I have Haunted in my hand. Can I let her discard that card? And I'm haunted. What's haunting me is the combination of how lonely she is, how lonely Vale was when she died, and how much her Crucible was frustrating, and now she's realizing she had it easy.
Interesting. I like that. Read the text on the block in terms of the mechanics of it so that I can see how it works.
When you use this card in a spread, one of your wingmates may discard a card and draw a new card to replace it, add the value of the discarded card to your spread.
See, the challenge with that is that you're not making a spread.
Right? I am the next one in line.
I'm going to rule against it on this one.
Yeah. Okay, okay.
I'm going to rule against it on this one.
Okay,
I admire the ingenuity, but I think I got to stick to the rule on this one. All right, so 4-1-1-6. Got it. Okay, cool. All right, so Crash, for you specifically, you're seeing almost like the POV ground's eye view. Sweetheart, what are you? Okay. POV ground's eye view of passing through a series of a section of the marshland that's ahead of the distressed area. You get a sense that it's possible you could redirect them that way, the bone chariots, which would further slow them down. But you also know that doing so would be risky. It would accelerate the process with which you would probably get noticed. And that's very much on your mind. So, with that said, who would like to go next?
Vale, did you say you
wanted
to go?
Yeah. Okay, so Feral Child is next to me, freaking out. So is everybody else. Do I have to be in combat to become hidden, or is that a decision I can make?
What does your talent say?
Oh, gosh. My talent just talks about ranged attack. It doesn't mention hidden.
I mean, you could, but I mean, you wouldn't really get advantage from being hidden where you are right now.
No, but I have Shrouded Bond, so I could pop out to Crash and Rama. I realize that would leave the Feral Child alone.
The Feral Child would follow you if you left.
I'm. If this
and
works,
you know
I would kind of.
That's fine. Accept it. Accept it.
Okay. I'm gonna pocket that idea.
Okay.
I'll explain after why I don't think that's a good idea. Yeah, I got nothing, so I guess I will look through the telescope for some sort of environmental obstacle that we could put in their way, and I'll check on the status of the town, which I will only be seeing the outside perimeter of the town.
You can absolutely do that. It would not contribute towards the overall success of the skill check, because the skill check is based on the mission of observing the behavior of the bone chariots and trying to distinguish what is powering them. So you can do this if you feel like this has this solves for the objective of, or the secondary objective of ensuring the safety of the town. 100% we can do that, but it would not get you any closer to you, the objective of your mission, before they reach that town. And that's fine. You are, but this is the choice you got to make. Do you want to solve the problem you've been tasked with, or do you want to save some civilians?
Now I'm caught between what Aaron wants to do and what Vale would want to do.
Right. And I'm going to need a decision.
Vale's more concerned with the town. Sorry, guys.
Okay. That's cool. That's really cool. So you are, what are you looking for specifically in regards to the town? Something to just slow the progress of the Bone Legion?
Yes. So something, some sort of obstacle in between the two.
Give me an intellect spread based on looking out of the telescope. And let me know what relevant bonus that you have.
That's an observation check?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, so 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. I'm going to hold on to my sparks for a minute.
13 on the cards, and then plus 5 for your observation. Okay, cool. So this does not contribute to the overall success. Your standing score on the extended skill spread is 21 still. What this does is it allows you, I would say that it allows you to see if they can somehow be funneled into that region that Smoke saw, it would buy you, you're willing to say, probably if you had to put a number to it, an additional 30 minutes, an additional 30, 35 minutes. That would, that said, it would, you don't know what it would require specifically to get them over there. You don't know what physical force could push them in that direction. You're not quite sure.
Yeah.
Crash, your turn.
Yes. Okay. I have a question, and then I have a weird idea.
I love both these things.
The question is, if I just start my way towards the village, like whatever the closest part of the village is that my spread?
You can make a... I'll just say straight out, your movement to the village does not require a skill spread. If you're trying, you can cover a certain amount of ground. I would say you could get probably a third of, you know, not even a third. I'd say probably like a quarter of the way there to the village on your own. If you want to make a physical skill spread to get to the village faster, you could do that, and then the success of that physical skill spread would accelerate that process.
Well, here's the thing. I want to start making my way towards the village quickly, but I also have an idea of how to help with our mission. And the idea is that I want to use my traveler skill specialty. Mm-hmm. But this is where the weird idea is. I would like to, as a traveler, knowing where the current location is, could I tell where they came from, and if there were any things that made them turn their path, what were those things?
Okay. Yeah, I'll say this. I'll say in order to determine that, you're going to need to actually go behind them.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Okay.
There's a good amount of distance between you and between them and the Bone Legion itself. Like, there's a good amount. So you could conceivably, with a proper skill check, position yourself behind them and in front of or to the side of the rest of the Bone Legion host to where you could determine and sort of like study their tracks. I will say you could do that.
This is terrifying.
Yes, it is.
He's essentially making us play through the Battle of Winterfell is what it is.
I mean,
yo, a hundo P.
We're outside on the field and just watching them all march towards us.
It's okay. As soon as the camera pans away from us, we know we will have survived.
Another question is, do I have a good sense of how long it'll take me to get behind them if I do that?
I will say you could do this all in one skill spread with a properly done skill spread. Yeah. And okay. I'll combine movement and observation into the same one. We'll count it as an scouting or traveler. We'll count it as a traveler check. Sorry, y'all. We'll count it as a traveler check. If you go ahead and do that spread now, we'll resolve.
All right. Doing it. Okay. So I'm going to use. I have a 3 grit in grace. I have a 4 in strength. I'm going to use a 2 in strength. And please let me draw a card that, okay. Well, I have a 4 in, no, I can't use that, can I? Because I've already used 3. Dang it. I was hoping to pull this trait card that would be perfect for this. You know what I'm talking about.
I do.
But alas, these are the 3 I pulled. I do have Hunter. Oh, no, I'll save it because for attack spreads. 3 plus 4, 7, 4, wait. 9 here.
Okay.
Plus 5 for Traveler, which is 14.
I'll 14. Go yeah, that's yeah. Fine. Don't burn a spark. That's fine. Okay. So, what, okay. 14. Okay, here's what I'm going to say. You don't position yourself directly behind them. You are able to, firstly, Rama, you just see Crash take off. It's not quite the speed of the Flash, but it is fast. It's not quite a Naruto run. It's not quite Feral running, but it is a sprint. That doesn't break stride at all. It's a weird, the sensation for you, Crash, you feel every rise and fall of the soil. You feel bonded to the earth. You feel like you're leaping from specific parts of the soil underneath your feet to another. That's how it feels like to you. To everybody else, it just looks like a very fast sprint. And you hit the mud and the distressed terrain of what the Phoenixes have been able to do to slow down the Bone Legion. You hit that, and then that feels, it immediately feels different. It feels like cold steel underneath your feet. The mud is hardened. It's got a very not cool bro feel to it, and everybody else on your earpiece can sort of sense that straight away. You don't get fully behind them. You don't call attention to yourself. You essentially go, not necessarily unnoticed, but you are of no concern to anyone. You can't study everything, but what you notice is a line of hoof tracks, or of hoofs and of tracks, where you can pretty much tell was this particular squad. And you notice it was a very, it was a hard angle turn, almost like impulsive, or if it was premeditated, it's either one of two things. Like, it was either spontaneous and just committed, or almost like how marching goes, where some go and then they just mechanically shift to a right column or a right flank. But it has that feel to it, that it was very distinct, very sudden. It wasn't gradual. It wasn't like a gradual turnout. It didn't pay attention or have anything to do with the way the terrain was. It was, we're going this way, and then all of a sudden we're going that way. So much so, you begin to wonder how, you begin to wonder if the village even matters to them.
Interesting. Okay.
That said, the trajectory is clear. We're at the end of this cycle, right? I normally would say Crash can pass the torch to somebody else. I'm going to ask that Crash pass the torch to herself right now to start off the new cycle. Okay?
Okay. Yeah.
So the trajectory is clear. What you can see is that, yes, it's heading towards the village, but you almost get a feeling that it's headed towards that first cottage in particular.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay, how close am I to that cottage?
If you give me a successful movement spread, I can get you there at the beginning of your next turn. If you make a skill spread, I can get you there. I can get you most of the way there now. What this skill spread is going to resolve is walking a mile in their shoes, in a very literal sense. You're going to be running a mile on their path. Where the success of the skill spread is going to be whether or not they notice you.
Okay. You know what? I have a decent hand, so let's give it a try. Also, I'd like to use... can I use anything here? Maybe, I mean, Traveler, I guess, if it's about walking.
I have no problem with you using Traveler again. That's totally
okay, fine. Great. All right, then. This might work. 4 in Grace, 3 in Strength.
Okay.
2 in Strength. Please be a trait card. Yes! I got Tough as Nails. Draw 1 card when you use this in a spread. During your turn, you may burn 1 spark and discard this card to remove all conditions affecting you during your turn.
You're fine.
I might need this later too. So
maybe, yeah.
Who knows? So I will go with this. So 4, so 5 plus 9. The other 5 is 10. So 14. Pretty good.
Okay, 14. Let me add that to your total. You are currently at 49. So, you blaze past them. As you pass by them, you get a good look at them. You are definitely closer than what you were ordered to be, but I think from your perspective, you're moving so fast, there's a solid chance they don't notice you. They notice you. You're too fast for them to get a hold of. You're going to eclipse them. You're going to be out of the range of them. They're not going to attack you on this round. But the lead chariot, the rider of the lead chariot, has much of the same uniform remnants that you're seeing. Definitely Civil War era. And for those back elsewhere, you get this image as well. Just a quick half-second glimpse of Civil War era for sure. Humanist side of the Civil War era for sure. For those in the our viewers as well as us here, the Civil War occurred about 230 years ago. The Empire used to be ruled by the Phoenixes when the Phoenixes were the Dawn Legion, or the Dawn Empire rather. A humanist separatist movement arose saying humans should be in control of humans. It was a very bloody Civil War that ultimately ended after a great battle that the Phoenixes won. The Empress of the time, who was a Phoenix, decided they're right. and she, after winning a great battle, ceded control of the Empire to the humans. From that point, Dawn Legion became Dawn Command to serve as protectors and to help maintain order within the Delayan Empire. That was the beginning of the decline of the Phoenixes, who did not really appear back into the world in force until about 8 months ago, I think, as of this, essentially with the initiation of the Dread. So with that in mind, you all very clearly see these are Civil War era corpses. What does that mean? You don't know yet. It just means that they all, at least this group, this particular section of bones, seems to be of a very specific era. Other details, the tube attached to the front of each of the chariots. Veil, that image sticks into your mind of what that cannon looks like. You get a pretty good mental picture of what it looks like. You do not know what it is, but maybe with some books you could decipher that, or talking to people and asking what it could be. Smoke, you get a strong absence of emotion. And Rama, I'd say that your big takeaway from that is just that quick, fleeting glimpse is it's a very distinct thing they're doing. And you don't know what it is, but these five in particular just seem very purpose-driven. The glimpse earlier of the main host are operating at a different speed, wavelength, purpose than these five. Crash, you are able to get past them, out of the reach. You don't know if they're going to physically react to your presence. You're not quite sure. But you're out of harm's way for now, and you're able to get, I'd say, 3/4 of the way to that lead cottage and to the town itself. It's the lead cottage. About 50 yards past that, it's an embankment of about 3 separate cottages seemingly together. Beyond that is the main village itself.
Okay, I have a quick question about the orientation of this. So,
yes,
is that lead cottage between the Eyrie and the town?
Or is great question.
Bone-leaf and the town.
Just, this isn't true orientation, but to just give perspective, village north. The cottage just south of that village, the bone chariots due south of that, and the Eyrie and the Verdant Coast to the west.
Oh, got it. So we came from the Eyrie.
Yeah.
And then I'm cutting south.
You cut south, and now you're cutting back north again. North.
Okay,
yeah.
Got it.
Yeah. Due okay, north. Cool. So, I mean, really it's north, northwest, but yeah, I mean, in all intents and purposes, that's fine to keep the orientation. Who would you like to pass the torch to?
Smoke, because Smoke has been
very I feel like I'm ready. So two things. So the Civil War era that you just mentioned, is that a feeling that we all like get now because one of us has gotten it?
That's the purpose of these comm links, essentially.
Yes.
These feathers.
I've been treating them as comm links.
Yeah, that's essentially what they are mechanically. Sure. They're called feathers, but yeah, the feathers are doing that for you.
So she sees that. She feels this strong absence of motion, and she like clocks that like sudden turn that they took. And it makes her like, it makes her think of animals again, quite honestly, like animals who like follow their instincts or even follow like generational, like instincts that have been like passed down to them, like in the way that like monarchs will like remember mountains that existed even long after they exist.
Yeah.
And so this is what Smoke brings at. So she sees all of this and she'd like to take it in, and then she'd like to sprint out of that room back to that original corridor we were in, look up at the Supreme Chapel ceiling, and follow down that like visual timeline. See if she can land on the Civil War era and see if she can find that cottage in the painting.
Okay. All right. What are your skill specialties again?
Athletics, fear, shadows, death.
Not a lot of fresco mural painting.
Should have
no art history.
No art history for bitters.
But I'm looking for cottage and I'm looking for Civil Era, and I know what Civil Era like stuff looks like because they're wearing it. And
here's what I'll say. I'll say that yes, I will give you this without a skill spread.
Yeah.
And I'm going to allow you to do something else for your skill spread to contribute to this.
Yeah.
In addition to this, I will say that the uniform lines up. Civil War, 100%. Mid-era Civil War. You don't see the cottage in the mural because the mural is more about, really about like specific engagements. Really about legend, battles of legend and lore. There is what I will say is that you do see, and I want to make sure I get the name of this right. Actually you wouldn't know the name, but what you're seeing and what you kind of like piece together and remember is part of the Empress, who was a phoenix, part of the terms of her surrender was that when she stepped down and abdicated power, she was a rank 7 phoenix, she actually took her own life, her final life herself. That was her sign, and it was her idea. She had agency over it. It wasn't like they demanded her head. She was like, no, this is what I'm doing to break this link once and for all. So there's a depiction of that. There's a depiction of her dying her final death, her rank 7 death, learning her final lesson, as you should say. Yeah. So theoretically, she's kicking around in the Crucible somewhere, and who knows if she's going to be someone's mentor at some point or time. Her name was I have it right here. I'm just trying to Justice. She was a Durant Phoenix.
Cool.
Her name was Justice, and from her sense of justice, she determined this was the final proper justice to do. Beautiful crafted armor, no helm, long flowing hair. And you can tell that this is a human made sculpture, but they have portrayed her with respect. This is not a polemic drawing. They are depicting her as like a final show of mutual respect, showing the passage of power from Phoenix to mortal.
Cool.
Cool. Now, do you want to do something else to resolve your check to contribute to us, or
yeah, I would. I would like to. Let me see. Well, basically, Smoke would like to look to the past to see what she can compare and contrast from what she examined, like is observing in the present. And I'm trying to decide if she would rather do that by looking up at the visual history, or if she wants to go back and see if she can find a book on it. I'm going to say she's more of a visual person, so I'd like her to basically try and like take what she's observed with the like almost like the formations that they like have decided like their own troops are taking, trying to like compare them to like what she's seeing above.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is going to be, let's call this a fear check.
Okay.
All right. So go ahead and give me a fear check. Okay. Go ahead and give me a fear check. Whatever you feel comfortable giving me.
Great. Vengeful. Yeah, I don't think I can use vengeful. Let me think. Okay, this is probably the best I can give you right now. Okay, so I've got a 4-4-2. So that brings me up to a
10.
10. That's a 10.
Plus 5,
15.
That is 15. All right. So that is 39, 54. Ooh, okay. Wow. All right. Okay. Let me consult my notes because I have a specific thing here. And then we got to keep moving. But what I'm going to tell you is that the Bone Legion is frightening in and of itself, but This particular, yeah, okay. What I'll tell you is that chariots are certainly an effective unit for accomplishing, you know, obviously on the field engagements, but they were really, you can tell that those cannons that they have on there are meant not just to destroy, but to cause intimidation by their effect. There's a term called fire for effect, which, you know, it's one thing to fire for accuracy, it's another thing to fire for effect, meaning you're trying to affect people on the ground. And I think you kind of learned this in a combination of your crucible as well as, you know, in your training before your first mission. You get the sense that whatever these things do, fire for effect. And you get a sense that they would be particularly damaging for phoenixes because it was a war against phoenixes. So whatever these things do, it would be something that was designed to strike fear into phoenixes. What is unique, though, is that five chariots on their own wouldn't cause much fear to a phoenix. Like, that's manageable. It's when chariots are dispersed as part of a phalanx or a formation that it would actually take that most effect, because it would, you don't know where you're going to encounter it. So this, in many ways, the behavior that you're seeing seems to be opposite of its stated purpose, and that it maybe has a different purpose. Who would you like to pass the torch to? And after you pass it, I'm going to pass it. So we'll do this next person you pass it to. And after that, I'm going to pass it back to Crash.
Copy that. Bria and Aaron, any of you strong? Otherwise, I'm literally going to click a coin. Let's send it back to Aaron then.
Okay. So Aaron, you see all this as well, and you're deducing a lot of this knowledge.
You get this all from the comlink as well.
Yeah. The other thing I'll say is that, as a quick observation, Crash, you look behind you and the chariots are going faster than you necessarily anticipated. You're still going to get to the cottage first before them. You're still going to have a minute, but it is clear now what has been removed from doubt is the ambiguity of their trajectory. They're going for this cottage in particular, which again, to the rest of you, is like, this doesn't make sense. If they're reliving the Civil War, why this thing? Why this particular building, this structure? Why these five chariots? That doesn't seem concurrent with anything.
I'm calling for a Tithe while also going to the table and looking to see if there's any history book.
Okay, you go to the table, and there are several books that a Tithe has pulled. You call for her, she runs over. The books on the table that she has pulled are, and I have titles, Military Tactics of the Imperial Academy, Great Generals of the Civil War, Dawn Legion to Dawn Command, The War and the Surrender, Evolution of the Talu Houses, Shaman, Spears and Surprise, Grimwald Guerrilla Tactics Then and Now.
Okay.
There are other books downstairs, but these are the ones that she has pulled and has been going through most recently.
MS, how well do you know Civil War history?
Oh, you know, master's degree in advanced Civil War field studies, collector of artifacts from the Civil War. I curate the museum in the capital. So, you know, I dabble.
You're familiar. Great. The cottage on the edge of, on the southern edge of town, any historical significance?
She goes over to the thing and she looks down there and she's like, absolutely not. There is nothing in story about any of this.
Is this area important at all?
Well,
aside from the Eyrie.
Heading this direction, not so much. The general Haldon Pelagus took attempted to take Baroque, but instead, before they could head down, managed their way down towards Sunset and then eventually Westerfell. Westerfell was the final battle of the Civil War, where he was killed in battle. But this direction seems to be the opposite path of that. In terms of the main host, in terms of the chariots, that's what we still can't figure out.
Well, it's opposite of where he died, but it's not necessarily opposite of where he's marching to. He would have marched across this path, wouldn't he have?
The histories are slightly vague about this particular region. You see, the Fens had essentially isolated themselves, so much of the history around this is not going to be written about in the text that we have. We know that Haldan Pelagius departed from the capital along the Summer Shore. They tried several times to take to the seas, to storm onto Pyre, but Dawn Legion in those days commanded the seas better than anyone. Instead, he harassed all of the major cities along the coast, but again, in the opposite direction.
And nobody knows what happened to him, you said?
No, he died. He engaged the Phoenixes in the final battle near Westerfell. I'll amend this later. I'm calling it Westerfell for now. He perished on the battlefield against the Phoenix Justice, but it was his death that motivated her to reconsider her position.
Okay, then just one more question. You realize they're being controlled, right?
I am not certain of anything. I know that they are dead, that they live, that they are bodies.
They're dead, they're moving, but does that look like random movement to you? That's in a battle formation.
They seem to be, go ahead and give me a, an intellect check based on observation right now.
Okay. Observation. So I've got six straight. I don't think psychometry would be helpful here, would it?
Read psychometry again for me.
You can discard this card and burn two sparks to learn the history and purpose of any object. But am I touching anything?
It says I
have to be touching it.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Then yeah, no. Unfortunately, you'd have to be touching it.
That's why I've been holding on to it.
I would say, no, here's what I would say. I would say include it in your spread. I'll give you a bonus for it since you're not touching it. Mm-hmm. I will say that your feather that connects everybody else gives you an approximate sense of it. So I'm not going to give you the full bonus of psychometry, but I will give you like a partial resolution to that. I will add 3 to your spread based on that card, and I'm going to give you a little bit more detail.
Okay. And then I get one more to cover that, right? One more intellect card to cover the trait card?
Yeah.
Okay, so 6, 7, 8, 9, and then the 3 were going to give me 10, 11, 12.
Okay.
Oh, I'm sorry, that was a skill check. 13, 14, 15, 16, 17.
17, great. That's really good. Okay. All right. So, your conversation points you... Like you're coming to a conclusion before you feel like you fully have it,
mm-hmm.
but in doing so, you're testing a hypothesis.
Absolutely.
Hearing her talk, you look through the lens of the telescope again, and you get a good look. Like it's got several like, kind of like you know, magnifying glass style additional lenses you can pop in and slide in. And what you're really looking for is the body language, because. You know, the base intelligence of a spirit or a geist of any kind would fall on routine. And what is routine for the military, but like specific marching patterns and a specific like tone to it. This doesn't have any of that. The movement, the general formation of the host, yeah, sure, it's generally arranged like, you know, a traditional Civil War army under the command of Haldan Pelagius would be.
Mm-hmm.
Or one of his, you know, contemporaries. But what? Oh, geez. But what you're noticing here is that It's a painting with a broad brush. It's not an individual spirit or ghost has like, it feels like it has like agency. This doesn't feel like it's agency. It feels like it's almost like a story being told. It's almost, it feels like a memory, but not necessarily their memory. That's what your gut is telling you. The facts don't draw to any conclusion, but just based on the images that you're receiving from everybody, you're getting the sense that what you're seeing is
a memory, but not necessarily of a battle that happened.
You're seeing memories happen.
Mm-hmm.
It's like a record being played. It's a song being played, and these are the instruments going through the motion. Or, you know, calligraphy, right? It's like it's something is being done that is transmitting something that happened to now. As opposed to a ghost, which is like, oh, I'm a
just
ghost.
Random energy.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Like, or yeah, just like, oh, I'm haunted. I feel like there's no feeling here yet. Or at least there's no feeling associated with what you're seeing. If there is intelligence, if there is a command, it isn't necessarily here.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to say at this point that the torch be passed back to Crash. Crash, you are 25 yards from the cottage. I will let you do general base level observations before making your check, before determining what it is you want to do.
Yeah, okay. So I approach the cottage. Is anyone inside? Can I tell?
Not. It's old. It doesn't look abandoned, but it also doesn't look like it's been forgotten. There's a fire pit outside that feels like it got somewhat recent use. It's humble, but, you know, whoever lives there takes a not insignificant amount of pride in the land and in the work that takes place there. There are no windows that you can sort of see. Small, probably 2 to 3 room cottage. Nothing terribly crazy. Probably not a big family that lives there.
Okay. Yeah, I guess I'm just going to approach it.
Okay. You approach it. You get up to the door. The bone chariots see you. They are on their way towards you. You've got roughly 3.5 to 4 minutes to do whatever happens here.
Before they get to me, to the cottage?
Yeah, they are hauling ass. So you have essentially a choice. You can definitely get more actionable information, or you can go into the cottage to see what's in there. If there's someone in there you could possibly protect or evacuate, you could, if it's a mortal, a regular sized mortal, you definitely have the physical wherewithal to move them to safety. It's really your choice what you want to do.
I'm going to bust open that door.
You bust open the door. And the room is a mess. Tables overturned. Two dead bodies on the floor. And in the center of the room, Jake, if we can see the whisper. the art on the card is not consistent with, I know, honey, it's so upsetting. The art on the card is not consistent with who this person is. But the whisperer in this case is a, I'd say, 15-year-old young man with a shocked look on their face. They are levitating about a foot off the ground. they seem to be floating with a look of horror on their face, various wounds across their body. Before you hear the song they're chanting,
oh no,
you notice someone else.
Okay.
A hooded figure in a cloak with their back to you. They seem to be constantly out of focus. You see a rod in one hand with what you swear to God you believe is the symbol of Dawn Command. And you hear a voice from this figure as their head slowly turns to you and they say, "You're a little too soon. I need a defense spread."
You know what? I'm glad I have all these grace cards in my deck, because that's my defense. Two grace cards. I got a 4 and I got a 2. I'm going to draw.
If you take a spark from the spark bank and you can draw 2 cards.
Great. 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 This is defense. So I'm going to go ahead and use blur of motion to dodge whatever the hell is coming my way. I'm out of cards. So, and I get to draw one more. Sorry, I'm going to shuffle super, super quick.
Come on, higher grace card. Please, higher grace card.
Higher grace card. Could use a 4.
4 of grace. 4 of grace. 4 of grace. 4 of grace.
All right.
Honestly, same, baby girl. Same.
The defense you have to hit is 14.
Oh my god! I got a 4 strength. Okay, so I have a 4, a 2. Oh wait, I got to draw 2 cards. Did I draw 1 or 2? I think I drew 2. Okay, 4, 2, 2. So that's 8.
Mm-hmm.
This is grace. Defense is grace. So, oh wait, I have uncanny agility, which means when I make a spread, I can use any one card as a grace card, regardless of its actual suit. That applies here.
Yes, 100%, 100%.
4 of strength. All right.
Okay, so what do you got? What do you got?
I have 12, right?
How many cards can you use in a defense spread, according to your combat style?
It says 2.
Yeah, so any 2 of those.
Oh, I can't use all of them.
No, you cannot.
All right, 4 of 4. I need to hit
use 14. Blur, right?
But blur is only
at least 2. I would say you can use the 4, and then the 4ing strength, and then if you can find a justification for blur, whatever that one is called, your justification for that.
My justification is 10. I'm trying to dodge whatever's coming my way.
Yes. Okay, I'll allow that.
10 plus acrobatics too.
That's a skill ability, not a defense ability.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, I know. So what's your point total based on?
Hold on.
Well, this 10. Yeah, I'm going to spend sparks for sure.
Spend 4 sparks, pull 2 from the bank, and that'll get you back up. It'll be net neutral.
Okay, cool. So I'm spending my 4, pulling 2 from the bank. Cool. And then I get those 4 back?
Yep.
All right, thank you. So I'm up to 14 now.
Okay. The attack came from not this hooded figure, but from the Whisperer. And as they start to chant an awful, piercing, horrifying song that, if you're familiar with sacred harp singing of the Appalachian tradition, it is very much like that. It's one person, but it sounds like infinite voices in a discordant melody, singing in a language you don't understand. What you you feel a telekinetic pull trying to slam you to the ground. You are able to dodge out of where that pull happened. However, as this happens, the hooded figure turns around to face you fully. Jake, can we bring up Omen?
A lot of scary cards today, huh?
Why is this spoopy? Why is it spoopy?
It's Halloween, y'all.
What? Is it? What?
Omen steps towards you and draws a blade. I know, honey. I know. And draws a blade that the last thing you see is the Dawn Command symbol on. And that's what we're going to leave for tonight.
No!
Millie hates it too. You all managed to make a series of decisions.
What kind of answer?
No, hey, this is listen. This is a very unique mission of observation. Yeah. So you made incredible progress on your skill checks. You've been able to deduce a lot, not the whole story as of yet, but you have been able to make incredible progress. But at potentially a cost. You also have to learn and contend with what it was that you just encountered and how that intersects with the overall happenings that happened here tonight. So, with that said, we'll resolve the fallout from this next week. This mission is close to being concluded. Chill vibes, yeah, chill vibes. Totally chill, y'all.
It's cool. It's going to be fine. I'm sure it's going to be fine.
It's fine. This is fine.
So we'll resolve the fallout from all that. This was fantastic. I loved seeing how the party was split in very unexpected ways. I loved bringing in a good mix of actual history and oral tradition from the locals. That was really fun to see. And yeah. Wow. We're really set up interestingly for next week. Until then, Dawn Command Fallout. Out.